All right, here we go, everybody. Welcome to the first of our three final Halloween Horrorthon episodes. Sadly, we have finally reached the final week of our month-long Halloween Horrorthon. I hope it has been just exciting for you guys to listen as it has been for me to talk and just produce these for you guys. This has been truly fun for me. Halloween is my time of year, and I just have a blast doing this. I've been having a blast doing this. Yes, I wish my daughter was here with me to host the majority of these, but unfortunately, these episodes aren't going to host themselves, and she had to take some time away, so now it's just me and these final three episodes. So, without further ado, the first of our final three. This episode is about Tales from the Crypt, Demon Night.
Universal Pictures is proud to present the motion picture directing debut of one of America's most talented and respected artists.
Cut! Cut, 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 cut!
Oh, hello, kiddies.
So glad you could join me. Your pal, the Cryptkeeper, has gone Hollywood in a big way. I'm directing my first feature film. Care for a little shriek preview? For my big scream premiere, I wanted lots of suspense. Special effects. Sex. Yeah. Violence. Your teeth into.
Hi!
Frights! Camera! Action! It's about a chase through the ages, a race against time, the war between good and evil.
Come on out, everybody! It's time to play!
And the final battle between man. Demon.
I'm not gonna hurt you.
I lied.
It stars Billy Zane from Dead Calm, William Sadler from Die Hard 2, and Jada Pinkett from Menace to Society. Ooh, I love those titles. And you'll love Demon Night.
The demon's here!
And ladies, if you think Demon Night is too gross and yucky.
Whoa!
Thank you.
All right, guys, like I said, talking about Tales from the Crypt Demon Night today. Yeah, originally this was supposed to be our Hellraiser episode. Now, let me tell you what happened with that. First of all, if you're just going off the schedule based off of the podcast episodes, then I implore you, please, to like our social media account, whether it be, I'd rather it be Facebook, because I'm not going to lie, that's what we pay the most attention to. But we're on Facebook, facebook.com/maddadmoviereview. We're on Instagram, instagram.com/maddadmoviereview. We're on Twitter, twitter.com/maddadmoviepod. And we're on YouTube, Mad Dad Movie Review. And yeah, guys, that's how we're, that YouTube, I mean Facebook, sorry, I'm getting a little sidetracked. I made a post the other day, and so if you follow us on Facebook, then you would know that we had a little change. Rather, I had a little change. And reason being is because of Madeline. She actually wanted to do Hellraiser, and when she heard that I was doing it, she kind of wanted to do that episode, participate in it, because she had heard from me that it's kind of a, it's a pretty brutal film, pretty messed up. I gave her a hint as to what happened with our character Frank in that film, and, yeah, she was, she kind of wanted to, you know, show off her genuine reaction to it with you guys. So I told her, you know what? We can always hold off because I got just the film to replace it. This is a film that, looking back, I'm surprised I didn't have in the initial lineup, seeing that I am a pretty big Tales from the Crypt fan. And yeah, Demon Knight is up there with some of my favorite horror films. It didn't quite crack my top 10. It's not up there that high, but Demon Knight is one that gets a lot of play in this house. And if you follow me personally on Instagram or Facebook, you have probably seen me post this film or a caption about me about to watch it or something more than a few times over the last couple years, because, yeah, I do tend to, looking back on things, post about watching this film an awful lot. So, yeah, I am here today to talk about it. So, that being said, let's just jump into the nitty-gritty.
So, let's get down to the nitty-gritty.
All right, here we go. Tales from the Crypt, Demon Knight was released on January 13th, 1995 from Universal Pictures. It opened up in third place against Legends of the Fall, Higher Learning, Dumb and Dumber, and Houseguest. Opening weekend box office was $10.1 million, going on to gross $21.1 million on a budget of $12 million. This film was directed by Ernest Dickerson, produced by Gilbert Adler, written for the screen by Mark Bishop, Ethan Reif, and Cyrus Voris. Music by Edward Shermer. Edited by Stephen Lovejoy, and cinematography by Rick Botta. Starring Billy Zane as the Collector, William Sadler as Breaker, Jada Pinkett as Geraldine, Thomas Haden Church as Roach, CCH Pounder as Irene, Brenda Bach as Cordelia, the legendary Dick Miller, as Uncle Willie, Gary Farmer as Deputy Bob, and John Cassier as the voice of the Crypt Keeper. All right. So, like I had mentioned before, this is a movie based on a television show from HBO that I grew up on, loved to death. It's a little horror anthology series called Tales from the Crypt that's based on the EC Comics from the 1960s and 70s. More or less, the show was circled around a different main star every week, more or less. Some episodes even directed. I know Arnold Schwarzenegger directed an episode in the show's second season that starred Kelly Preston, called The Switch, also starring William Hickey. Anywho, I'm getting sidetracked. So the show had different big stars, and the episodes usually ended in terrible fashion. The main star never came out on top by the end of the episode. Let's put it that way. It happened more often than not. And again, I keep on saying it, like a lot of big actors ruin this show. Some of them in big appearances, some of them in minor appearances. I know Tom Hanks directed an episode that he also has a minor role in. He's in the episode for like maybe a minute and a half total screen time, long enough to get brutally killed. And yeah, so the show lasted 7 seasons and it spawned 3 films total, 2 theatrically, and then the third film was kind of pushed quietly years later down the road, direct to video. That one's called Ritual, stars Tim Curry and Jennifer Grey. I've never personally seen it, but I've heard it's for the best. Demon Knight, missed out on this one in the theaters, unfortunately, but I was sure as hell there when it first came out on VHS. I remember when this came out on video, random, stupid, useless trivia, Blockbuster Video. Back in the 90s, they started this whole, when they started the one-day rentals with the old, it had a red little slip in there. Like when the movie came out for the first 2 to 3 weeks, they were only one-day rentals, not two, like typically. And this came out around the time that started. I remember when this came out and I saw it for the first time, my copy that I rented had a red ticket instead of the famous blue one. And apparently that was to indicate that you could only watch it for one day and then had to go back. So anyway, don't know why I'm talking about this right now, but whatever. So yeah, the movie from the show, of course I'm in. William Sadler's in this bad boy. He's already been in a few episodes of the show, so he's a fan favorite of the series and the film, of course. And then there's Billy Zane. I mean, what more can I say about Billy Zane in this film that has not already been said? And speaking of things that I have to say, let's talk about them critics, shall we? Let's go over to the critics corner real quick. So Demon Knight has a Rotten Tomatoes score of 36%. That's from 33 reviews, a Metascore rating of 48 from 23 reviews, and a Letterboxd average score of 3.4 out of 5. Variety wrote, the film is neither funny enough nor scary enough to be fully satisfying as either a shocker or a spoof. Stephen Holden from the New York Times wrote, it half succeeds at being chilling and funny. David Cronk from the LA Times called the film a direct-to-video affair that was given a theatrical release based on the strength of the franchise. Let's see. Our buddy Owen Gleiberman at Entertainment Weekly gave the film a D+ and wrote, is there anything more dispiriting than trash that flaunts its lack of conviction? I don't know, buddy. You seem to hate a lot of genre films, so you tell me. The San Francisco Examiner called it a slime and gore fest that offers little but a few outrageous sick jokes and the chance to make a mental list of all the horror movies from which it borrows. Edward Guthman from the San Francisco Chronicle wrote that, though the film is dull and slow-paced, if I were 12, I might have loved it. Fun fact, my daughter is 12, and something tells me she would have loved this. She's never seen it, but anywho. And finally, Chris Egertson from Bloody Disgusting called it one of the most underrated genre entries of the 90s. And Chris, buddy, I could not agree more with that statement. So, that's what they had to say. How about what I had to say? Because you know I love this film. So why do I love this film? Well, first off, I love this film because it's a Tales from the Crypt production. Let's just get that out of the way first and foremost, okay? Who's bullshitting who here? I love this film because of Ernest Dickerson. I love this film because of Dick Miller. I love this film because of Billy Zane. I love this film because of battery-operated nipple clamps. I love this film because I've always appreciated the inclusion of Roger Rabbit in this. I love this film because, no, that's me giving you the finger, asshole. I love this film because I've always thought Breaker was such a badass. I love this film because it kicks off the filters, hey man, nice shot. I love this film because the blood seal concept always wowed my 12-year-old self. And finally, I love this film because it's original. And still to this day, this is an original script. All right. Side note, I don't know what it is about this episode in particular. I don't know if it was the fact that I just came back from a 5-day getaway camping for the first time in 15 years. I don't know if it's the fact that I'm just excited about covering this film. Or I don't know if it's just the fact that I'm just now starting to get comfortable with doing this. I don't know what it is, but I just feel like I'm having a good time doing this, and I feel like I'm making less mistakes than usual. I'm more casual with this. Maybe you're hearing a difference. I don't know. Let's just keep on going. I just wanted to throw that out there because I'm just, you know, letting things go. I'm not tripping on my words as much, and I feel comfortable, and that's what's important, right? All right, so getting back to a Asiasi host, let's talk about the film's origin. So, Tales from the Crypt, Demon Night started as an original spec screenplay written by the film's 3 credited writers, Rife, Voris, and Bishop, years before it became a Tales from the Crypt affiliation. The original mandate was to do 3 movies under the Tales from the Crypt name, all different like an anthology. The original 3 films were to be Body Count, Bordello of Blood, and From Dusk Till Dawn. That film was going to be the 3rd and final of the trilogy until negotiations with Tarantino fell through. So when that film didn't happen with them, Demon Night got bought and was now the first film of a new trilogy to also include Dead Easy. The script was polished to feel more like a Tales from the Crypt film, and so on and so forth. They brought on Dickerson, and Dickerson brought on his crew, and a movie happened, guys, and a damn good one at that. So yeah, I guess at this point we can just jump into the movie if you want to. Let's do it. Let's just jump into this movie, and here we go. All right, so the film starts with the Universal Pictures logo, followed by the famous Tales from the Crypt introduction in high definition for the first time ever. It starts with a woman laying in her underwear on her bed. She's covered in blood, on the phone with what appears to be her lover. She's telling him how she did it, and it got her all hot before describing how much she enjoyed killing him and how much she cannot wait to spend their money. She then tells him he's in the basement cooling off. Now, the guy we're talking about here appears to be her husband down at, you know, your typical little silk stockings-esque plot setup here. But with a twist, of course, because it's a Tales from the Crypt. Because next we see a dead body in a tub of acid, followed by the woman who is now taking a bath upstairs. Cutting back and forth between the two, we see the melting dead body reanimate before slowly walking up the steps, featuring a cool shot, by the way, of the fingers kind of sticking to the handrail as his quickly decaying corpse is falling apart as he's walking. The woman's continuing to clean herself in the bathtub upstairs as the corpse finally makes it up to her, holding an axe as she questions what took him so long and what kind of cologne he's wearing because he smells terrible. Then she turns around, removes the rag from her head, and sees that there is a corpse standing there about to kill her. She screams in bloody murder as we suddenly hear the Cryptkeeper yell, "Cut, cut, cut," and it's revealed that he's the director, been filming a scene for his new movie all along. So this is our big introduction to the Cryptkeeper for the movie. He begins ridiculing the corpse actor, who's played by John Larroquette in a hilarious cameo. Cryptkeeper goes on to tell him that he's no Gory Cooper or even a Robert Redford. There he is with them puns. It's a pretty funny moment. Before noticing the audience is watching him, he then welcomes everyone back and explains how he's gone Hollywood in a big way before introducing the film's story, one he calls Demon Night. So now we get the opening credits set to Filters. Hey man, nice shot. As we see Breaker driving down a deserted road at night in the desert. It's next revealed that he's being chased by the Collector in another car. Now Breaker here, played by William Sadler, and the Collector, played by the hilarious and just all around amazing in the role, Billy Zane. I mean, that goes without saying, William Sadler is fantastic in his role. They're both great. They really are. But I mean, Billy Zane here, man, he's not even cranking it to 11. This dude's cranking it to 24. I mean, he's just breaking barriers with this character, and I'm loving it just as much as he is portraying it. I'm just, yeah, it's good. It's great stuff. It really is. So Breaker notices he's out of gas, and he turns his car so that he can point the gun. He can put the window down and aim his shotgun at the Collector as the Collector is speeding towards him. Breaker fires off 5 rounds before realizing the Collector's going to ram him. He's going to ram him anyway. So then he narrowly escapes before the two cars collide, setting off a fiery explosion. Pretty big stunt, too. Breaker gets up and runs off after looking down at his hand, which has 4 star tattoos on it, to reveal 3 more stars appearing in a circular form. So this is going to be the first of our many appearances of these star tattoos on his hand. It's going to come into play in a big way towards the tail end of this story, but just remember this. Remember the tattoos. So then Breaker enters the small town of Wormwood, New Mexico later that evening and first attempts to break into a car at a cafe before being spotted by a young teenager named Danny. Running off back into the night, Breaker eventually runs into Uncle Jack, who tells him he knows a place where he can bed down for the night. This is where we're in. Oh, and Uncle Jack, played by the legendary Dick Miller. I can't say enough things about the guy. If you've seen any Joe Dante film, if you've seen the old Bucket of Blood, if you've seen Gremlins 2, well, they're Joe Dante films, never mind. But if you've seen anything 80s genre related, this man has been in, from Shopping Mall to Gremlins, as I mentioned, to The Terminator. I mean, he's in everything. You name it, this guy pops up. To The Howling. I mean, yeah. Dick Miller is in everything. God love him. So now we're introduced to Sheriff Tupper and Deputy Bob, who are investigating the crash when the Collector reveals himself coming around, walking around the fire, saying that it was his car, and he asks if they saw him. He says the man he's chasing is dangerous and warns them that he's going to be a danger to their town if they don't stop him. That's when we cut back to Breaker and Uncle Willie, who are walking in the night in the desert towards a building that appears to be an old church. On the way, Breaker stops to look down at his hand again, this time revealing the 7th star tattoo shifting from the center of his palm to the circle formation of the other 6 before telling Willie it's just the place he's been looking for. So then Willie and Breaker enter the old church to reveal that it's now a hotel of sorts, with Uncle Willie telling the woman at the desk named Irene, played by CCH Pounder, that he's got another customer for. We're then introduced to Cordelia, who is a call girl who also lives there. Cordelia, played by Brenda Bach. She's hanging out with Irene when the two walk in. Breaker checks in with a large stack of 100, says, and checks in as Mr. Smith, and is shown to his room by Geraldine. In his room, he asks Geraldine which way town is as he's checking it out in a paranoid manner. She tells him before mentioning she's going down to get the rest of his stuff with a sarcastic tone that town is that way, pointing in the other direction. She says the concierge will be there momentarily with his bags. Geraldine's working there for Irene as part of her work release. It's never really mentioned or acknowledged or gone into any depths or detail as to as to the situation, as to why she's there, what happened, what kind of work program this is. It's just referred to in the film as work release, and it's just kind of like briefly mentioned casually, if not, you know, in a couple of scenes, and that's it. Kind of would have liked to have seen some more there, but it's not that kind of movie, you know. Another person staying that we're introduced to is played by, I mentioned Roger Rabbit earlier, Roger Rabbit, voiced by Charles Fletcher. He's in this as a character named Wally, who's a post office worker. He's seen telling Cordelia how unfairly he's treated at work. And it's obvious that he's got a big crush on her, but she's not interested in him like that. When Geraldine refuses to get Cordelia's sheets out of the dryer, Wally then goes and offers to go get them for her. She says, thanks, that's nice. And then when he leaves, she goes over to Irene and mentions how she should just give him a freebie. And then Irene's without a beat, just comes back with, that's just what the man needs, someone else screwing him. It's pretty good stuff. The collector is now seen driving in the back seat of the state trooper of the trooper car with Tupper and Bob. He's being questioned on the way about their speeds and the damage that was done when the sheriff gets a call about Breaker's auto theft attempt from earlier. Cut back to the hotel again. We got Breaker layering his bowl of green mess with ketchup. Not sure what the hell this stuff is. It's kind of just, it's mentioned. It's the stuff that's put in there. It's hinted at. It's not really said what it is. It's just some nasty stuff. Then again, they could just be breaking Breaker's balls. So he goes and proceeds to eat this stuff like he hasn't eaten days. Someone pulls up outside, which startles Breaker. He jumps up out of his seat. It's revealed to be just a regular named Roach, who is there to see Cordelia. As the two go upstairs, Wally walks in with her sheets and a jealous look on his face. Irene is seen calling someone on the side on the phone. So then we got Tupper and Bob again. They're wrapping up their visit with the automobile owners who called the police. When Tupper gets another call from dispatch saying Irene's calling them about the guy they're after. So everyone at the hotel is listening to Cordelia and Roach upstairs. Breaker then asks Geraldine what she's there for, and she answers stealing as the police show up. And this is it. That's the only time it's mentioned throughout the whole film, stealing. And then that's when the police show up. The collector warns Tupper, or Sheriff Tupper, that Breaker is armed. And this is when Breaker takes out his butterfly knife and holds it to Geraldine's neck as he yells for everyone to drop their guns. Both of the police officers point their guns at Breaker and yell at him to let her go, along with everyone else. He eventually does and is cuffed over the table. When the collector asks for his key back, his pouch is revealed to be empty. This is when Bob goes up to search for to search Breaker's room for it, but instead only finds Cordelia and Roach in bed with a battery and nipple clamps. He orders them downstairs with everyone else. And this is where Tupper tells Bob that the computer came back saying Frank Breaker died 5 years ago, and the two begin aggressively questioning him about who he is, just to tell them where, and then they get on him about telling him just where to, you know, where's the key. Back to the key. Uncle Willie then chimes in, eventually revealing that he saw him stash the key under the table before going under it and pulling it out. Right before he goes to give it back to the collector, Sheriff Tupper reveals that both cars from the crash were reported stolen, and so now they have to arrest both men. They're going to take them both back to the station. So when Tupper begins escorting the collector out to the car with his gun, the collector turns around and punches him right through his head. Gnarly effects right now. Frightens everyone. Irene blows chunks. He eventually pulls the sheriff's head off of his body while trying to get his arm loose. And here we go. Breaker frees himself with Bob's keys and gets punched out by the collector while he's still got Tupper's head stuck to his hand. After he does that, he goes to further attack Breaker and gets scolded in the face by the key. This is the first of many, many times we're going to be seeing this item, this MacGuffin, this whatever you want to call it. The collector then jumps outside through the window and begins this monologue.
Humans! You're not worth the flesh you're printed on! Fuck this cowboy shit!
You fucking ho-dunk, po-dunk, well then there, motherfuckers!
All you have to do is give me the goddamn key! Then we could get on with our lives! Alright, this property is hereby condemned.
So he begins by splitting his palm open with his claw, allowing green blood to ooze out as he throws his hand around everywhere, or just dashing blood all over. The green blood drops then proceed to go into the ground, and out comes slimy demon creatures as everyone watches in horror from inside. Power suddenly goes out and everyone's distracted. When they redirect their attention to the collector and his demons, they're all suddenly gone. This is when the demons begin getting inside from the windows. One by one, they start attacking. One attacks Deputy Bob until Breaker takes a revolver and shoots both of the green eyes out, which kills them. So this is the first time it's revealed that to kill the demons, you have to shoot out both of their green eyes. It's kind of like the rules for Gremlins. You got to question it. This, it's just like, just go with it, okay? Shoot the green eyes, okay? And in fact, later on, Billy Zane's character kind of like has a little fun with that rule, so to speak. So where am I? Breaker kills a second demon by the one that's attacking Irene, and then he seals the front door with the blood inside of the key. So back to this key. This is the item that Breaker is possessing, and inside of it is blood that is first. It's revealed here that when you pour blood into a doorway or a windowway, it seals it. There's a little invisible seal protecting it from demons, so they cannot get through. So that's what he does. He's preventing them from coming through the front door. And then he saves Geraldine by throwing his knife into the demon's eye that's attacking her. And then he seals up another entryway. But then a demon breaks through it. And this is what happens when the demons cross through the barrier. They just explode, more or less. They explode. It's pretty nasty. And they get destroyed. So Roach, he tries to get Cordelia to make a run for it with him at the front door. When they go out, they're attacked by the demons. He pushes her out of the way to save himself, and that leaves her to be attacked by a demon outside. This is where Wally tries to play hero, takes a gun, shoots at it multiple times. Breaker yells for him to hit him in the eyes, which he does, but does not get out of the way, because after you hit him in the eyes, this like green lightning shoots from their heads or their eyes, and these bolts in particular blast Wally up to the front wall, and he gets knocked down. He's next safely pulled inside by the survivors, and then this is when Breaker explains to everyone that they have to make it through the night. Roach, once again, wants to give Breaker up to the collector, but Breaker says they'll die anyway. He then goes upstairs to seal up the windows. While doing this, he comes across the cross on one of the windows he's sealing, and then he has one of several visions throughout this film. It's a vision of Jesus Christ being approached by a demon while holding the key. Now, I wrote in my notes that it's Jesus Christ. The more I watch this movie, the more I realize it's not actually Jesus Christ that's being approached in this particular scene. It's more of like a servant. The servant extends his hand to the demon, and lightning strikes it, causing him to painfully fall to his knees. Back at the hotel, Breaker's confronted by Geraldine, who thought he needed some help. He tells her he's sorry about her missing cat and about the knife from earlier, and says he wasn't going to hurt her, and she says he knew he wasn't because she has a feeling about him. This is when she asks who he really is, and he tells her he's just an old man running out of time. Roach begins taunting Cordelia and Wally because of his crush on her and the fact that she's now comforting him. He tells her that whore ain't got no friends before walking away. Breaker comes back downstairs and covers the sheriff's body before taking it away from everyone. While in the kitchen, Geraldine's cat suddenly returns. Breaker asks who let it in and can be possessed by and can be possessed before chasing it into the basement. Against Geraldine's pleads. Meanwhile, Roach and Wally have another confrontation, and Roach reveals he's after the key so they can get on with their lives. Cordelia intervenes and he takes her into her room where he threatens her not to see Wally. She then tells him she's not scared of him, and this is when he starts to hit her and he tells her she better be afraid of him. Cut back to the basement. We got Breaker searching for this cat along with Geraldine. It jumps into her arms and he checks it with the key. A breeze is then revealed coming from the back of the cellar basement, or the basement cellar. And then we got a lot of cutting back and forth going on. Cordelia back upstairs. She's crying in her room alone when the collector is heard telling her how beautiful she is and how unfair she's being treated, and how if she just lets him inside, he can make sure she doesn't have to live like this anymore and finally be free and happy. She sees him outside reaching out for her as the scene suddenly ends. Then we have Wally coming in and he begins being seduced by a changed Cordelia. She's still in her same human form, says how he really loves her and she agrees before kissing. Cut back to the cellar. It's revealed that the breeze is coming from a secret tunnel that leads into the town. It's like a mine shaft, more or less. This is when they hear Wally screaming from upstairs. They run upstairs to the room, and when they enter, a demonic Cordelia is tearing into a dead Wally before mutating more into a creature. Irene attempts to save an attacked Breaker when her arm is then ripped off. It's pretty... they don't cut away, and the effects in this shot are pretty outstanding, especially for 25 years ago. Breaker then... Oh, did I forget to mention this is the 25th anniversary of this film? Yeah, I should have mentioned that at the top. My bad. Breaker then blows Cordelia's head off with a shotgun, followed by the two eyeballs that came out separately. Irene's being tended to by Bob and Geraldine. Geraldine pours vodka on the wound, but Irene takes the bottle and begins drinking from it. Geraldine and Bob tell Breaker they have to get Irene out before she bleeds to death. Uncle Bob says he remembers how to get through the mines that are in the basement. Breaker says no one's going anywhere, and what makes them think the demons haven't found the mines themselves yet. This is when Roach confronts Breaker and tells him he's tired of him making all the decisions for them, and he wants to give the collector the key that he's after before Breaker then pulls the gun out on him and he backs down. Breaker says if anyone goes into the mines, he can't help them. Roach says he's going anyway, and everyone follows him down to the basement. Breaker enters the basement with Roach knocking on the boards with a sledgehammer to get into the mine. And then from watching that, Breaker cuts into another flashback, this time from watching Roach bang on the board with the sledgehammer. He's now seeing that as the sledgehammer making contact with the wood. He's seeing as Jesus Christ being crucified with nails being nailed into his hand, being nailed to the wood. The crucifix, sorry. And this is when a demon is approaching a servant before some of Christ's blood drips down onto its hand, burning it. This is when the servant takes the key and fills it with Christ's blood from the crucifixion. The demon then grabs the key as well, and both of their hands begin glowing red and burning together as the servant screams, and we cut back to Breaker in the basement. Roach then, at this point, breaks down the wood, and they enter the mine shaft. After entering, last, Breaker seals it with some of the blood from the key. So now we're in the mines. They're walking through the mines, everyone, kind of together. Some of them kind of split up on their own, like Geraldine here. She eventually finds the boy Danny from earlier. He's there, lost and scared. He's clearly scared, and when he goes with Geraldine, his parents suddenly appear as demons, and they start attacking them. Everyone falls back and returns to the basement with the seal protecting them. That's short-lived, though, because Roach, hero of the day, Roach, takes that shotgun from earlier, breaks the seal by firing off a shotgun round through it to kill his former co-worker, who is now a demon. The demons now enter the basement as everyone runs up to the main floor of the church and then to the second floor, which Breaker seals behind him after being the last one up. So at this point, everyone's now catching their breaths. Breaker begins questioning Danny about what he was doing in the mines. He says the man from earlier came back and got his parents, so he ran away. Breaker then checks on him with the key and tells him it's good to see him again. The group now reveal that they're low on ammo. So Breaker cuts to another flashback to being a soldier that begins with him shooting another soldier in demon form. He then falls back to check on another soldier who's bleeding out. This soldier fills the key with his blood, then hands it to Breaker. By the way, this soldier is named Dickerson, named after the director, Ernest Dickerson, who takes the key and holds it while it begins glowing red and gives him flashes of the crucifixion and demon moments we've previously seen throughout the movie. Breaker screams as his hand is revealed to now carry the 7-star tattoos as he hears a voice telling him, "You're the one, Breaker. You're the one." Back to the hotel/church, Roach asks Breaker how he intends on saving them, or how he intends to save them. He says they just have to survive the night. Roach calls bullshit, and Irene tells Breaker they deserve to know the truth after what's about, you know, everything going on. They deserve better than that. Breaker then proceeds to tell them when he got there earlier, he thought they'd be safe because there was only 5 of them and they need 7, but the collector brought Bob and the sheriff along with him, making it 7. He says it's like the tumblers in a lock. Everything has to line up. 7 stars, 7 people. But then loses it when Willie mocks him. He reveals his hand and says he didn't ask for this. And this is when he decides to tell them all that's going on. And it goes kind of like this.
You want to know what's going on? Shall I tell you? In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth.
You're talking Genesis. That beginning?
And the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep. But the darkness wasn't empty. It was full of creatures, full of demons. And they had 7 keys formed into a circle that focused the power of the cosmos into their hands. Until God stepped forth and said, "Let there be light." And there was light. And he scattered the demons. And he scattered the keys all across the universe. And we fast forward about 2 or 3 million millennia. Now the demons are back. They got 6 of the keys. And one day they find the 7th key here on Earth. Now to save it, God filled it with the blood of a carpenter who was being crucified by the Romans. And he gave it to a thief named Sirach.
The blood inside? Is that?
Some of it. Yeah. It gets used, you see. Sirach had to refill it. Bad neck wound. Talon caught the artery here. Most of what's in here now belonged to a soldier named Dickerson. Gave it to me in France, August 23rd, 1917. Funny how you remember the big dates, isn't it?
Jeez, that would make you,
what happens when you run out of blood?
They bring back the darkness.
Just like that.
Just like that.
So. Now you know.
So next, Roach, once again, extends his hand to Breaker to apologize, and when he accepts and the two shake, Roach pickpockets the key from Breaker's jacket. So Danny is suddenly missing, having walked away during Breaker's story. When Geraldine is searching for him, the collector tries to turn her by suddenly making the room she's in turn into a gallery full of her photographs and art. He tells her how young she is and how much potential she has and how Breaker can't get her out or save her. She ends up spitting in his face and walks away, but the thought is still clearly on her mind. That spitting in her face, remember that. We call that foreshadowing. Willie and Danny are found in the attic together by Irene. Danny's in the corner reading Tales from the Crypt comics. I thought that was pretty funny. While Willie's drinking from the stash he's found there, Irene sends them down to Breaker to come up with his key and then discovers a large bag of mail. Roach is watching the demons down below from the second floor. He taunts them by spitting down at them. They blow back, and in a pretty funny moment, Breaker says to him, "They hate it when you do that." Uncle Willie walks into the room looking for Breaker, only the room he's found appears to be a rooftop bar full of a handful of topless women who are all over the man as he walks towards the bar. The bartender is revealed to be the collector, who offers Uncle Willie a drink, who is seen taking it along with the second one. Knock one back, Uncle Willie. Here's looking at you. Meanwhile, Danny's confused because he's not seeing everything that Uncle Willie's currently seeing. So Irene finds that Wally was planning on going postal all along when she discovers that there was a crate up there full of guns and grenades in it, along with a handwritten note revealing his plans. This is when Deputy Bob mentions if he really was planning on doing it, then he didn't have any bullets to do it with, showing the gun clips being empty before setting his sights on a real grenade vest. Breaker and Geraldine enter the room Willie and Danny were in to find it empty at first, but then Willie appears in demonic form and viciously attacks Breaker as he yells for Geraldine to help him. She's reluctant at first due to their closeness together, her and Uncle Willie. Because at one point, he turns to look at her while he's holding up Breaker in human and demon form. He turns to look at Geraldine, and he's back to his human form, and he says, "You wouldn't hurt your poor old Uncle Willie now, would you?" So yeah, she's hesitant at first, but then not so much. What happens next is the collector. He's trying to negotiate with Irene with her arm on a platter, but she instead blows him off by saying, it's my favorite quote in the movie. She takes her stump and kind of like moves it up, and he's like, "I'll take that as a yes." And she's like, "No, that's me giving you the finger, asshole." So he just goes away, and we got Demon Willie still attacking Breaker while Geraldine begs for him to stop, holding a knife in his direction before being thrown into a corner. This is when she's had enough, grabs a machete and takes his head off. While all this is happening, Roach gets the collector's attention and says he's ready to make a deal. Back with Uncle Willie and company, his head's now off. However, the rest of his body is attacking Breaker still, until Danny takes the head and shoves it into a pair of deer antlers' eyes first, killing him. Back in the hallway, it's the Roach and Collector show. They're talking still, leading to this dynamite exchange.
"How do I know you ain't gonna kill me?"
"You have my word. I mean, frankly, we've been counting on you, haven't we? The world needs more people like you, Mr. Roach."
"Thank you."
"You're welcome. Of course, you don't mind if we kill the others, do you?"
"Hey, if it makes you feel good, do it."
"Makes you feel good, do it." "Exactly." "First things first, of course. The blood seal."
"Listen, on a personal note, be sure and kill Breaker. He's a bossy asshole."
isn't he, though? Thank you.
That's it?
Ooh, that's it.
You know, you ain't such a bad fella.
You aren't so bad yourself. Pleasure doing business with you, Mr. Roach.
Well, you know this hell on earth business? Big fucking deal. I got hemorrhoids. Vaya con Dios.
And a vaya con Diablos to you too, sir. Oh, Roach, there's just one more thing I forgot to mention. I lied.
And vaya con Diablos to you too. So the collector's now entering the top flow, to Breaker's dismay. The top floor to Breaker's dismay, but it is immediately taken out with a sudden arrow shot through the eye from out of nowhere by Breaker. Everyone gathers together into the attic next as Irene is shown strapping herself with the grenade vest from earlier. Bob is firing all the demons until he runs out of ammo, and this is when him and Irene hold each other's hands together as she rips the pin cord on her vest, saying, "Supper time," and they explode along with everyone else. Boom. Rest in peace. Breaker, Geraldine, and Danny remain in the attic. As soon as the explosion goes off, Danny finds a pair of real evil eyes in the comic panel looking at him. Breaker tells Geraldine there's only enough blood left for one entrance. He then proceeds to pour it all out onto Geraldine's hand so that she puts her finger on it and then puts that dab of blood on the window panel next to her, sealing it. Just as Breaker begins to make Geraldine the new key holder, a possessed Danny attacks him as the comic he was reading begins flipping through pages. In a pretty cool sequence, the comic's flipping through, the wind's taking it, it's revealing different pages that are like illustrations and drawings of Danny attacking Breaker at this during this scene. Geraldine is tearfully begging for him, pleading for him to stop. Breaker drops the key as Geraldine goes to recover it. This is when she gets knocked across the room by Danny, but then she gets up, and as Danny goes to walk towards the key, meanwhile, I forgot to mention, in this moment, Danny's mouth is growing, like, massively, like, extremely wide so that he can devour Breaker in one, basically, a whole. So he's walking towards the key with this big open mouth. It's like something out of Beetlejuice, it looks like. And Geraldine just kind of, like, gets up, jumps up for a board to give her more traction as she... kicks him more or less out through the window that was sealed, and he explodes. And this is when we get a shot of his smoking shoe hitting the ground. Breaker is now on the verge of death. He tells her she's ready for the key. She hands it to him, and he fills it with his own blood from the wound on his chest that was caused by Danny's tongue. He takes her hand, and the two hold the key as it glows red. She has the same flashback glimpses we've been seeing throughout the film as she becomes the new key protector. Her hand now possesses the 7-star tattoos as Breaker tells her that when the 7 stars align, she'll know what to do. He says he can't tell her how long that'll take. It could be an entire lifetime, maybe several, but that on the day she'll fight, and when the night is over, she'll do just what he did. Breaker then dies, leaving Geraldine all alone to face the collector one-on-one. With Breaker's death now means that all the seals throughout the church are nullified, so we get shots of all the seals that were made throughout the film, and they just vanish. So it's open season, and the collector wastes no time. He busts through the attic door, revealing himself from a green light. He sees Breaker's corpse and opens the eyes that Geraldine closed just moments before. He then begins taunting her before telling her to just pour the blood out and get this over with. Geraldine reveals herself to be covered in blood from head to toe, and this is when Breaker thinks that this is when the collector thinks it's cute because he doesn't know it's actually Breaker's blood. and he grabs her by the arm, and it burns him. He then dives out of the attic through the door that he came from, and Geraldine slowly follows after him. She goes and enters the bathroom. This is where we see a shot of Sheriff Tupper and his mangled head and body that are inside this tub. Geraldine notices that the shower curtain's missing, and the collector suddenly appears from behind her, wraps her in the missing shower curtain, and throws her into the tub, turns it on, starts to clean the blood from her or off of her. While this is all going on, we see Geraldine take a drink of blood from the key after jamming it into his eye. And then she jams the key into his eye, thinking it's going to kill him, but it doesn't. The rest of the blood's then poured into the tub by the collector while he's explaining how the eyeball attacks only kill low-level demons. The collector then drags Geraldine downstairs into the hallway, or not the hallway, the main room. He's dragging her while she's still wrapped up in the curtain. Takes her down there while delivering an insanely long villainous monologue that features a random dance number and some other antics, pissing fire is another thing that happens. It's crazy. It's crazy. It's something that it's kind of hard to explain. It's something you have to see for yourself. I mean, I can't even put this thing into audio form, because it's just, you got to see this movie for yourself and check out the final 15 minutes. If anything, it's for Billy Zane's role or his performance alone. Like I keep saying, knocks it out of the park. The man's up the bat, and he's hit 5 home runs already this game, and it's not even over yet. So after a while, Geraldine ends up spitting the blood that she's had in her mouth the entire time into the collector's face, which then begins melting, and his body is set on fire and turns into some sort of like a skeletal king demon. The entire place then explodes before fading into the following morning, with Geraldine waking up, filling the key back up with more Breaker's blood, and then catching a bus out of town. It's also worth mentioning that when she gets on the bus, you know she's going to seal that entrance on the bus, and that's exactly what she does, because we see the bus arrive at another bus stop where a man in a suit holding a briefcase stops before entering, looks around the entrance, and tells the driver, "Nah, I'll just wait for the next one." The bus then drives off as we hear the drifter start whistling the famous Tales from the Crypt tune, while the camera cuts over to a grassy area where a hand suddenly pops out of a gravesite and pulls down the roses that were sitting atop. It's then revealed that it was the Cryptkeeper who had pulled these down. He is getting ready to attend his film's premiere. We cut to the premiere as the Cryptkeeper gets out of the limousine that he's in with two other women who are dressed up. He walks the red carpet, greeting everyone and delivering his usual puns in the process. He does all this until he reaches two men presenting a guillotine in front of him. This is when the Cryptkeeper proceeds to get his head inside as they pull the rope and the blade comes down, knocks his head into a basket where he maniacally laughs as the screen fades to black and the end credits roll. And that is that on Demon Night. All right, so before we get to the wrap up on this, I do have more trivia than I have had in the last few episodes. All right, here we go. Starting from the top, Universal originally wanted Cameron Diaz for the Geraldine role, but Ernest Dickerson fought hard for Jada Pinkett, and, well, you know, that turned out. The green slime in the film was made with disassembled glow sticks. The film was shot for 40 days inside of an airplane hangar to avoid constant night shoots. Because of this, there were an abundance of pigeons that were on set being loud, so the crew came up with, before every shot, they had to have someone with a shotgun, an actual shotgun, and before they roll action, The person had to fire off the shotgun to quiet the pigeons for several minutes, like 5 to 10 minutes or whatever. Not firing at them as in trying to shoot them, but shooting for, you know, the noise. This film was Billy Zane has been quoted saying it's his favorite role. Billy Zane's bald head and Jada Pinkett's short blonde hair both surprised the producers on the set because they both arrived. Billy Zane was different. He arrived pre-production. I mean, with a briefcase. They were telling a story in the documentary on the Scream Factory disc. He's got this briefcase that he walks in with on day one. And he opens up the briefcase, and it's just an assembly of different wigs. And he's like, okay, which one do you want me to wear for the film? And Dickerson's like, nah, just, I want you to go for your natural bald look. It's you. It's the character, definitely. Jada Pinkett, in her situation, was a little bit different because I know she got hired when she had longer hair. I think this was back when she was doing Set It Off. And, just showed up with short, bleached blonde hair, and they were gonna do something about giving her extensions or a wig, and she wasn't having it. And hey, Jada won in the end. Good for her, though. CCH Pounder was in a fat suit. I didn't know that for years. She was in a fat suit to make her character look older, and also helped with her character's missing arm gimmick later on in the film. It helped with hiding her arm, more or less. Zane was offered Titanic because of this film. The release date coincided with Tales from the Crypt's original series finale on HBO. I remember this. So this movie premiered, like I mentioned earlier, January 13th, 95. A week later, the series ended. Now, this was back when this series was originally going to wrap after season 6. Season 6 was announced as the final series, but then a year later, after the series ended, it was announced that the show was coming back for one more season that took place in London. The entire season, like, was a whole British cast. Daniel Craig's in an episode. Ewan McGregor's in an episode. Kerry Fox is in an episode. Bob Hoskins is a bunch of British actors in that season. And that came after the fact. That aired the summer of 96, if I'm not mistaken. This was intentionally released on Friday the 13th weekend. And when the Cryptkeeper's character is walking around on set, it's a puppet head superimposed over a real actor's body who was wearing a green mask. So that is the trivia I have for Demon Knight. Without further ado, let's wrap this baby up. So Demon Knight has a body count of 14. My unbiased MVP pick for the film goes to none other than Billy Zane. Do you really need to know why? My Be Kind Rewind most rewatchable moment goes to Billy Zane's little monologue speech on the outside when he's when the demons arrive. That whole moment, I could watch that because it's just got some of the best dialogue that I've ever heard in something that of this magnitude. Like, it's just insane dialogue, and that entire scene, that 5-10 minutes, yeah, it's hands down my favorite moment of the film. My double feature pairing, I would like to watch this double paired up with Candyman, the original 1992 Candyman. These films have a lot more in common than you think. You put them two together, and I think that makes for a great and powerful double feature. Sticking to the genre, they both have overall good messages. Not good messages, but they're what I'm trying to say is they're powerful films. And my star power. My final star rating, 4 stars. 4 stars for Demon Knight. And my final thoughts on the film. So Tales from the Crypt, Demon Knight, while it's not a film for everyone, especially in today's society, it's It's a horror film that was released during a time when studio genre films were dumped and left to fend for themselves. 25 years later, I'm still talking about it and knowing it has quite the following. It's a movie that has rightfully earned its spot in horror history. Billy Zane was born to play his role as the Collector. He's so goddamn good in this that it's impossible for me to even see anyone else in the role. Bill Sadler as Breaker is a reminder of the pure talent that that man possesses. Next to Haywood from Shawshank Redemption, it's his finest effort. And I mean that. A very young and talented Jada Pinkett is also featured to give us the taste of her bigger career to come. It's always a party whenever Dick Miller shows up. So, of course, it was a pleasure seeing him in this. But why not? It's Dick Miller, you know? Thomas Haden Church, he takes the asshole jock role and amplifies the shit out of it. The great CCH Pounder, she's just legitimately one of the funniest characters of the whole movie. She definitely makes me laugh, even so 25 years later. The directing is super impressive for someone without a horror background, and I give all the credit in the world to Ernest Dickerson for that. Even if you are never into the show or haven't seen it in years, now's the time for an honest rewatch. It's just this movie. It's good stuff. And you still got time left. There's still time. So I'm gonna wrap things up. Well, I just did, but I'm going to wrap up the episode altogether by just reminding you guys that you can always listen to previous episodes when iTunes, Spotify, Google, Apple Podcasts, Breaker, Stitcher, Anchor, and all that jazz. Facebook.com, Mad Dad Movie Review, Instagram.com, Mad Dad Movie Review, Twitter.com, Mad Dad Movie Pod, YouTube.com, Mad Dad Movie Review. But Facebook, if there's one thing I want you to follow, it's Facebook, because that's what I update the most. Emails, questions, no, if you have questions, comments, requests, email maddadmoviereview@gmail.com. This closes the book on the first of our final three episodes of the Halloween Horrorthon for the year. Later on this week, we've got Freddy vs. Jason, and then I am wrapping up the entire month of October with a personal favorite of mine, 2007's Trick or Treat. That will be this Friday on the show. And then November, looking like November's looking really good. Taking a break, except for 1 week, we're going to be making horror's going to be showing its dirty face for one more week in November. That's because of Child's Play 2 on November 9th, which I will be getting to as that episode gets closer. Until then, other films coming out. I know we're doing Boyhood. I know we're doing my all-time favorite movie for Thanksgiving, Planes, Trains, and Automobiles. I know we're doing Shawshank, something that I mentioned earlier in this episode. And it's gonna be fun. And I'm looking forward to wrapping up Halloween. I'm not looking forward to Halloween itself being over. But yeah, until then, if you're listening to this in current times, we have 1 week, one final week left before the big election, and I cannot drill it into your head enough to vote, and to vote smart. That's all I'm gonna say. I love you guys. Thank you so much for listening. It means the world to me. Don't forget to leave reviews if you can, like us on social media. Let's keep this thing going. I love doing this show, and I would love to hear more from you guys. We got a couple more episodes left for Halloween, and yeah, that's it. Until then, stay safe, social distance, mask up, Take it easy.